Section 1.4, interpreting and evaluating functions using graphs. Some goals for this section. We're going to talk about how to use a graph of a function to evaluate the function, solve equations and inequalities involving the function, and determine the domain and range of a function. We're going to use a graph to determine if the graph actually represents a function. We're also going to use the graph of a function to determine where the function is increasing, decreasing, and constant. So let's get right into some examples. We're given a graph and we're asked to use the graph to evaluate the following statements. So now we see this graph and we see x on the horizontal axis and f of x on the vertical axis. And so that tells us that y is a function of x. All right, so we're asked to evaluate f of 4. We're asked to evaluate f of 4. So remember, in this notation, that means that my input, my x value, is 4. All right, so f of 4. When my input is 4, what is my output? The output is 5. F of 4 is 5. Evaluate f of negative 3. If my input is negative 3, what is my output? Negative 5. F of negative 3 is negative 5. Find the values of x for which f of x is negative 3. Now remember, that's the output. That's the y value. Where is the y value negative 3? Alright, so what I'll do is, here I have this, here's negative 3 on the y-axis, and I'm just going to draw this horizontal line, and notice that it hits the curve at two places. Find the values of x for which f of x is negative 3. We would have x equals negative 2, x equals 8. So there's two values of x for which f of x is negative 3. Find the values of x for which f of x equals 5. Similarly, find where the output is 5. I'll draw that horizontal line. And again, notice that it hits twice. X equals 2, x equals 4. So that's how we can use a graph to evaluate a function and to solve an equation involving the function. So compare those, right? Evaluate f of 4. The input is given. Find the values of x for which f of x equals negative 3. The output is given. And the process for answering those is a little bit different on each one. Now we have an inequality. For what values of x is f of x greater than 1? The first thing we're going to do here is we're going to see where f of x equals 1 using a similar process. So remember, that's the output. Where is the output greater than 1? All right, well, where's the output equal to 1? So if I draw that horizontal line at 1, notice we have two critical points at x equals 0 and at x equals 6. But it didn't ask us where is the output equal to 1. It says where is the output greater than 1. So notice that if I look at any of those points sort of on the inside, which I'm now drawing in blue, any of these points have outputs greater than 1. But wait a second, it's saying for what values of x? What x values? Well, What are those x values? The x values go from 0 to 6. So, we can write this in one of two ways. As an inequality, we can write 0 is less than x is less than 6. If we want interval notation, we write parenthesis 0 comma 6 parenthesis. For what values of x is f of x less than or equal to 5? Again, that's the output. Where is the output less than or equal to 5? Well, let me first think of the equation and find those critical points. Now it's an equal to, so I'm going to put some solid points where the output is 5. Now, we want the outputs to be less than or equal to 5. So I could shade this part of the graph because all of those outputs are less than 5. And I can shade this part of the graph because all of those outputs are less than 5. But it's asking for x values. So let me now smash this to the x-axis. Our first interval would go all the way from the left up to 2, and we can think of a solid there, and we go from 4 all the way to the right. So, using inequality notation, I could write x is less than or equal to 2, or, and we have to have that word or, x is greater than or equal to 4. Using interval notation, I would write parenthesis negative infinity comma 2 bracket. We use the bracket when we have an inclusive inequality. The or equal to tells us to use the bracket on that 2. We would use the union symbol bracket 4 comma infinity. All right, so what about domain and range? We have this graph. Domain, recall, is the set of all valid inputs for the function. And we see we've got some arrows here, right? We have these arrows going all the way to the left and all the way to the right. And everything's connected in between. So the domain is a set of all real numbers. I'll use negative infinity, infinity. State the range. Now, those arrows keep on going all the way to the bottom, but there is a definite top to this function. And that top is at 7. So, here's what we can say for the range of the function. We can say that the y values must be less than or equal to 7, or we can write that using interval notation as parenthesis negative infinity comma 7 bracket. State the intervals over which the function increases. Function is increasing if it's moving upward from left to right. So notice that the function changes from increasing to decreasing at this value 3. Right? It changes there. Where is it increasing? We will say that it is increasing on the interval negative infinity to 3. It's increasing right up until when x is 3. Where is it decreasing? Well, it starts decreasing just after 3 and it continues decreasing forever on. So from 3 to infinity. So that's how we can determine domain and range and where a function is increasing and decreasing just from the graph. So here's another graph. and let's answer some questions based on that graph. All right, evaluate f of negative 7. We have a standard scale here, so when the input is negative 7, the output appears to be 7. F of negative 7 is 7. Find all values of x for which f of x is 0. Recall that means the output. Where is the output 0? I see 2 points where the output is 0. So x equals negative 6, x equals 0. For what values of x is f of x greater than or equal to negative 8? All right, so let's find where the output is negative 8. Since it's an equal to, we'll put solid points. So there's where the output is negative 8. There's 2 points. We want the output to be greater than or equal to negative 8. Well, all of these points that I'm now shading in purple have outputs greater than or equal to negative 8. Now, let's smash that to the x-axis. And I'll write this in interval notation. Where is f of x greater than or equal to negative 8? It is greater than or equal to negative 8 on the interval negative 8 to negative 4. I put brackets on both because I have solid points on both sides. Union, bracket, negative 2, comma 1, bracket. State the intervals over which f increases, decreases. All right, so where is it increasing? Where is it decreasing? Notice that that changes at x equals negative 3. Where is it increasing? It's increasing on the interval. It's increasing on the interval negative 3 to 1. Now we do not include the 1, so we use a parenthesis there. Where is it decreasing? It's decreasing from the interval on the interval from negative 8 to negative 3. Remember, when we describe intervals where a function is increasing and decreasing, we always describe it in terms of the x values. State the domain and range of the function. All right, so the domain, let's erase some of this stuff here so we can see the graph again. Where's the domain? Well, it doesn't continue on to the all the way to the left. It doesn't continue all the way to the right. In fact, the domain has very specific boundaries. It's connected everywhere in between. So the domain, I will write as the interval, bracket, negative 8, comma, 1, bracket. We can include the endpoints. They are part of the domain. And finally, the range. The range, we have a minimum at negative 9 and a maximum at 16, and everything in between is included. So the range is negative 9, comma 16, brackets on both ends. So let's look at an example of a graph in context. Here we have a graph that shows the number of remaining tickets, n, for a show as a function of the time in hours, t. We're asked to evaluate n of 5 and interpret in context. All right, so first let's evaluate n of 5. So that means that our t value is 5. So we have n as a function of t. n as a function of t. So when t is 5, at this point, which is not exact, but let's say it's about 8300. So I'm going to say that n of 5 is 8300. All right, so this graph shows the number of remaining tickets for the show as a function of time and hours t. So n of 5 is 8300 tells me after 5 hours there was approximately 8300 tickets remaining. Find the t values where n of t is less than 4500. Interpret the meaning of your answer. All right, so let's find where n of t is equal to 4500. All right, so right there. And so then all of these shaded values have outputs that are less than 4500. All right, smashing that to the x-axis. So n of t is less than 4500 when t is, let's see, the lower boundary is 10 and the upper boundary is 16. So between 10 and 16 hours, after tickets went on sale, there were less than 4,500 tickets remaining. And finally, let's look at how we can determine if a graph represents a function. And if you recall from the previous section, we said that the definition we were going to use is a function is a relation where each input has a unique output. So if we think of, we have these graphs, and if we think, well, is it a function where our input is x and our output is y? So then the question is, does any x value produce more than one y value? And so we can quickly do this by using what's called a vertical line test. If I take vertical lines and I draw them along the curve, at any time does a vertical line touch more than one point? And the answer here is no, right? One point, one point, one point, one point. Every time I draw a vertical line along that curve, it only touches one point. Is this a function? Is y a function of x? Yes. Y is a function of x. Now let's contrast that with this second example. Let me just draw one vertical line right here. Notice that that vertical line touches more than one point on the curve. So therefore, no, y is not a function of x. All right. That concludes the presentation for section 1.4.